Sorry, that's fair enough. I tend to keep my time, so I was absolutely aware of this. Let me start by thanking the organizer for the invitation. Let me also specify that both the paper and the presentation have been jointly written with Massimo Fornosare, that is here in the audience, and also that I have probably contributed more to the pre-modern part, and while Massimo has contributed more to the modern part of the presentation. To a greater efficiency that has been recommended, I will be conducting the presentation alone, so take responsibility for timekeeping. This said, let me I can use this one. Okay, thank you. In the presentation which follows, we have tried to provide a critical profile of the long-term evolution of social-oriented banking in Italy. Of course, for a more detailed and nuanced picture, we refer the audience to our paper. Italian cities have pioneered not only credit practices from very early stages, but ways to discipline such practices as well, responding to pressing ethical and social concerns. We have identified two key periods. The first one in the chronology refers to, I would say, the invention and the spreading of socially oriented credit agency, possibly the first network of credit of socially oriented such agency. Then, lasting pretty much from the late 15th century, I would say, to the end of the 18th century, early 19th century. Then a second phase of deep renewal of social-oriented banking in the 19th century, a model that lasted through the 20th century. Then we close with, I would say, a question mark, because new arrangements have deeply changed the sector. In a way, this may be the end of a system. It could also be a new beginning, as it has happened many times in the past. As credit activity expanded the reach to become vital service necessary to the functioning of urban economy, Renaissance Italian cities introduced a high degree of specialization and a series of converging provision and innovation designed to structure credit service to render them sounder and cheaper. At the lower end of the market, they introduced pawn banks, a remarkable institutional innovation which can be regarded as the origin of social banking and the benchmark of a socially responsible consumer credit. The picture clarified the very idea, the ideology of the Monte di Pietà, a mountain of surmounted by the figure of the Man of Sorrow. Pawn banks were designed to provide emergency credit. Monte di Pietà provided the venue for the temporary liquidation of non-monetary forms of wealth. They extended short-term credits, generally up to 12 months, to meet the need of those who had no other source, and they did so according to strict ethical rules. Fees on loan were to be kept low, usually around 5% a year, sometimes lower. in order not to burden borrowers, yet adequate to cover cost. In roughly half a century, starting from the early 1460s, the first monte opened in the heartland of Italy in Perugia, in Umbria, in 1462, over 130 such institutions sprang up in town across central and northern Italy mostly, but soon they moved to southern Italy as well. By the 18th century, the number of monte dotting the peninsula was in excess of 700. That is a map that can provide somewhat of an idea of the chronology and the spreading of this network. In the 17th and 18th centuries, Monte moved into a broad range of banking services and went far beyond the original mission. But wider financial operations were tailored to provide more abundant and cheaper credit to those in need. In fact, profits from standard banking transactions went to reduce the cost and even to make it interest-free of petty distress loans. As a result, Monte played a crucial role in both assuring a higher degree of liquidity at the lower end of the market and reduce the cost of short-term borrowing. Second phase, the renewal of social-oriented banking, the political upheaval caused by the French invasion of the 1790s caused a financial meltdown and left the credit system across Italy reeling, not just the pawn banks, but the old, much more sophisticated and complex system at other levels. Pawn banks survived, but their ability to operate was restricted, and they came to be increasingly perceived also as outdated. The credit sector experienced a deep restructuring, and new institutions designed to combat poverty were imported, such as saving banks, cooperative mutual banks, and rural credit unions during the opened up during the 19th century. A new model and new goals emerge. According to the new tenets of saving and providence, economists of the age promoted, working class people were no longer deemed unbankable. Saving and mutual banks had an explicit moral purpose and encouraged people of low social standing to exercise self-help and thrift. After Italian unification, socially and ethically responsible banking enjoyed broad political support and was the most vibrant segment of the modern Italian credit system, and was to remain so for decades. At the outset of the 20th century, saving bank and mutual bank were more numerous than conventional banks, and they had a much wider territorial reach, especially in the less advanced region of the country. Conventional banks were outnumbered by a ratio of 16 to 1. Saving bank and mutual banks enjoy high level of trust and claimed over 56% of deposits. Italian social banking had up and downs and underwent restructuring and downsizing during the 1920s and 1930s. In the long run, this streamlining did not prove damaging, though, and there is no doubt that both saving banks and mutual banks remained key pillars of the credit system and came to play a crucial role in the post-war Italian economic performance. Donato Menichella, governor of the Bank of Italy in the post-war years, had no reservation in supporting local banks with a social outlook, since they were the only ones able to understand and to address local need in a suitable manner. Between 1946 and 1980, gross deposit at saving bank and credit union leaped about one-third, from about 30 to over 43% of the total. Loans follow a similar upward pattern, jumping from about one-third to over one-fourth to over one-third. Saving bank and credit union contributed not only to strengthen local economies, but cared about the overall well-being of the communities they operated in. And let me conclude with the question mark I referred at the start. That is an epilogue, a new beginning. The growing need to operate in an international environment and to achieve greater efficiency and performance led to a reorganization of the system. The legislative banking reform of the 1990s introduced radical changes. The removal of former restrictions allowed most saving banks and mutual banks to drift away from their social and local roots. Thus, one can say that an unprecedented change with as yet unforeseen consequences had been set in motion. After more than 600 years, socially oriented banks, as we have known them so far, with their available knowledge and social capital, are actually becoming an endangered species. They have become fragile and have started, to a certain extent, to disappear in part of Italy. The issue of balancing profit and ethics is once again of the greatest relevance and thus perhaps for new imaginative solution. Thank you.